to agree a rate of surface water discharge with United Utilities. This rate will be low so that it does not impact on drainage further down downstream in the network, and attenuation plants will be built underground on site to hold water when there is heavy rainfall. This should mitigate any potential impact the scheme would have on the drainage network. Generally, we have met the planning requirements in regards to minimum interface distances. Removed trees will be replaced with new native planting, and we have taken into account comments received. The scheme will provide a mix of affordable homes for local people on currently derelict sites. The objections raised related to hives and drainage are issues that already exist and will still exist whether this scheme is approved or not. Taking that into account, we have done as much as possible to make sure that our proposals do not impact on the worsening situation. The scheme is similar in layout to that which is already approved, but has less units and a higher ratio of off-road parking spaces. We feel this new proposal has met all relevant policies and is a more suitable scheme for the site than that which is already approved.
Thank you, Rachel. Lord Councillor?
No.
Councillor, I'm happy to be some more of these walls. Can I just put up some photographs with my explaining to the wildlife park and the petitioners to talk about that issue. The gap that is being highlighted by the residents, because Fenderby Road, unfortunately for the way the design in the past has been designed, where the houses on the front overlook the meadows which were the horses on from Fender Farm, and the rear of the houses is where the parking is. There's no off-street parking for any of the properties on there, and it comes as about 70 properties which are the rear of Hayfield Place and the rear of Fender View, of which Magenta Living are developing a further 5 properties on Fender View Road, further down where there was a block of garages that's demolished from the plan application for that particular plot. But the issue is about the narrowness of the road and the accessibility. And you can see the cars, and this was taken just after lunchtime in the afternoon, in a working day, so you can imagine what it's like of an evening when there's more cars about when people are coming out from work. And just obviously to note that obviously the issues around the tailing head and accessibility conversation, I'm quite relieved to hear that Magenta Living will have no objection to residents using the tailing, but I'm sure the residents who move into the property will, and there is no additional facility. Where the turning point is now is where the garages are, and there's actually 2 cutouts into Hayfield into Fender View where it allows the emergency vehicles and the bin wagons to turn out at the moment. They would have to turn down in any area. I would like the planning committee to approve the application, but we ask the following matters to be taken into consideration. The condition 3 is strengthened to say that all construction traffic should be off Stavordale Road in the interest of safety and to comply with policy HS4 of the Money into the Development Plan. And that's because obviously it's been highlighted to you that the access is via next past a main primary school, December Primary School, which enters into Sedgefield. It's right as opposite from the main gates for the school children going in. We'd like condition 5 to be strengthened to ensure that a 6-foot fence or greater is not placed in front of the existing homes which are on Hayfield Place. where the new perimeter line will be to ensure the satisfactory outlook for the current residents and to ensure any landscaping enhances the visual immunity. And regards to policy GR5 of the Wirral Unitary Development Plan. Additionally, any further clause should be added in relation to the maintenance of the communal gardens, as this has not always been the case in respect of new magenta builds, and is currently an outstanding matter of concern for ward councils and residents about the developments that they've had now on the neglected perceived. We would like the constituents 11, 12 and 13 to be strengthened with the area where the development is taking place. In addition to the surrounding area, as others suffer from pathways and gardens flooding, which is increasingly worsening in the area, and on occasion millimetres from going into the homes of residents. It's a factor on the opposite from our highway departments who have been around these neighbourhoods on many occasions. The issue is that the drainage was never put in to actually be suitable for the amount of properties that there. So it's an ongoing issue that we have with United Utilities. The Magenta Living is part of our discussion with them. And the clause reflects upon protection for future occupants, but should also state protection of the existing residents. So that's one of the clauses which needs to be added with existing residents as well. And any mitigation that can take place to improve on the current flooding situation would be greatly appreciated, especially some of the members of former and existing Magenta tenants. Therefore, we feel Magenta should operate with a duty of care and consideration. In summary, and in closing, the residents would like to see that the access to the whole site of the construction and the general access to be from STAVORDALE ROAD, as they will be believed to be there will be a dimensional change to the area, but this is not the case in relation to parking and not in accordance with council policy HS4. Furthermore, we ask for the strength of condition 3, 5, 11, 12 and 13, as previously outlined in the order, to be compliant with policies HS4 and GR5. We should not be looking to exacerbate problems already known to us in relation to parking, flooding, access to bin areas, and emergency vehicles by restricting the use of the table care. Thank you for allowing me time to make my recommendation on behalf of the residents. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. So I'll open it up to the committee. Christina?
Can you tell me a little bit of this if they also use the famous new road as an access?
Thank you, through the chair. As I outlined in my presentation, and as you heard from the applicant, Fender View Road has always been part of this scheme, an extension of Fender View Road. Originally there were 14 units down there. This proposal reduces that units by 4 down to 10, and it also increases the number of parking spaces at this part of the site as previously approved.
Yeah, just on that, you said it's been reduced from 14 units to 10. It's my understanding that it's gone from 14 apartments to, how many apartments is it now?
There were 30 apartments, there's now 4.
In terms of access from Bellevue Drive?
There were no
apartments.
I'm not in mind. Just like clarification from the highways, there have been, issues raised here about Fender View going in there and you know, specifically getting into bin lorries. I mean, what's the position with like sorts of emergency vehicles? Can you give some clarification on that, please?
Thank you, Chair. As Matthew said, the number of properties involved here on the access for Fender View reduced from 14 that was previously approved down to 10. There will be an adoptable turning head provided as well, where there isn't currently an adoptable facility to turn around. In terms of highways, I don't see there's any grounds to object to this proposal.
Okay,
in relation to the access along the Fender View.
Yeah, I was just going to pick up on one of the points that Ron made about specifically with regards to condition 3 about the construction management plan. Is there any way we can strengthen from that to make sure that there's no construction traffic trying to access the site from the View Road?
That's a really good question.
Thank you, Chair. I don't think that that condition does need to be strengthened. It's strong enough in terms of what we're trying to achieve. We were looking for measures that are submitted as part of that scheme, and we obviously consulted our colleagues in highways to ensure that appropriate routes are put in place during construction of the site. I think it is sufficiently strongly worded and it meets the 6 tests of a planning condition.
Is there anybody else who might ask a question? Well, the officer's recommendation is for approval, so could I have a proposer? And seconder? You have a seconder? All those in favour of the officer's recommendations for approval? Against? Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you, through you, Chair. This application seeks permission for amendments to a scheme approved in April this year. The site has had planning permission for the erection of a dwelling in December 2013, and as I said again, in April 2015. Therefore, the principle of this proposal has been established with the 2 early permissions. Just looking at this plan, on the plan in the screen in front of you, this is the permission that was granted in 2013. The dotted line is the permission that was granted in April of this year, and the block print is what's now being applied for. Work has already commenced on site, with the driveway access having gone in and the outer shell of the proposed dwelling commenced. This application seeks permission for a slightly different position within the plot and some elevational changes. The overall design remains largely as approved in April, with some minor changes to windows and the introduction of 2 Juliet balconies. The scale of the dwelling remains as approved. Separation distances between the application property and adjacent houses are considerably in excess of 21 metres at 45 metres window to window. The balconies do not overlook adjacent properties but look out over the fields to the rear of the site. Having regard to the minor changes proposed from 2 previous approvals, it is considered that the proposed is acceptable in terms of its site and scale and appearance. The application is recommended for approval and there is a qualified petition of objection.
Thank you, Matthew. Would the petitioner like to come forward? If you just use that silver button at the bottom to switch your microphone on, and just state your name and you have up to 5 minutes to speak.
Thank you, Chair and Hall. Firstly, we would like to point out that this is in fact a retrospective planning application for a dwelling that has already been constructed in breach of the existing approval. This is not just an amendment. The facts are that the dwelling has been built higher, closer and rotated towards the existing properties that it backs onto in Spain. This has enhanced the new dwelling through improved views of the River Dee estuary and a significantly larger south-facing garden. The committee should also be aware that a large amount of preparation work was carried out on the site before the first application for dwelling was made. A large natural pond and watercourse were filled in, of which recent flooding has impacted our local residents significantly. Also, a large number of oak trees were felled before Wirral Wildlife were even involved in the Planning Commission when back to farm to use a willow tree and the only standing oak tree left. We can only assume now that other oak trees were being used by bats as well. We would like to review some of Mr. Lacey's points as he has addressed as the planning officer. Point one, house built at variance to the previously approved scheme. This may very well not be a valid reason to refuse the application, but as it was not applied for before being built, it gives rise to a complete lack of faith and trust with the builders and the applicants who have shown all the way through this process to have complete disregard for local residents and neighbours. Point three, the council considers the scale, height and design of the approved proposed dwelling to be acceptable. Let's be clear. This property is not in keeping with most of the surrounding properties, which are either dormer bungalows or dormer houses. It is the largest house in the vicinity and specifically the widest. It has been purposely built almost a metre higher than the Planning Commission and without having hipped roofs, as it has an overbearing impact on residents. How high and large would it have to be any endowed, asked the committee? There seems no boundaries here. Point four, the dwelling does not have detrimental impact on the character of the street scene. Which street scene is the planning officer referring to? Is it from Gayton Parkway? If so, then we'd probably agree. If from the Spinney, then myself and 36 other petitioners, including every resident living in the Spinney, would strongly disagree, as it most certainly does have an impact on the local area. And many visitors have stood shocked and in disbelief at how it has changed the street scene. Has the officer actually been to view the street scene from the Spinney? Under separation distances, the planning officer has written the orientation of the dwelling also reduces any possible feeling of overlooking. Who is he referring to? Because we categorically deny this statement, as it is the absolute opposite and cannot believe that this has actually been written. We did not object so vehemently to the previous plans because it was to be built at an angle to ourselves and 16 Spin. We politely now invite anyone to visit our properties and see for themselves how this new orientation has made the property sitting any better. In fact, it creates a brick wall and terracing effect that's 67 feet long and 25 feet high. It is now virtually parallel to our property. The planning officer goes on to state the intention of the trees also retains the appearance of mature vegetation along the boundaries of the plots in the area and acts as a buffer between the site's neighbouring properties. Again, we categorically disagree with this statement as the buffer of landscape
has been
shot down and we are left with one solitary oak tree to block out 67 feet of property. All the upstairs windows now directly overlook the main bedrooms of 14 and 16 the skin, causing a huge loss of actual and perceived privacy. The gardens are completely overlooked. Now that the shell of the building and roof covering has been completed, the full impact of the development is apparent. It really is difficult to visualise the true size, scale and impact from the plans. We therefore make the strongest appeal possible to the committee to arrange a visit to 14 and 16 the Spinney to assess its full impact on these homes prior to deciding this application. If this is not possible, we respectfully request that this application be refused and the house be built to what was approved plans. However, should approval be granted, we request that the following modifications are added to retain privacy and lessen the visual impact.
I'm really sorry.
Sorry, that's 4 minutes. It's not 5 minutes.
We have actually timed this
evening. That's been 4 minutes exactly.
Got it
at 5
as well.
We just have time here. We set the time when we started.
Basically, we would like some amendments made. We would like some assurances given that there will be some privacy given back to us. If this building is going to be approved,
I'm going to have to ask you to stop the representation now. Sorry. Thank you very much. Would the applicant or agent like to address the committee? Again, if you state your name and you have up to 5 minutes.
Okay, my name is Paul Lewis. I'm the lead contractor for the job. I suppose I just wanted to come to so the committee didn't think it was a building firm, we were just doing whatever we wanted. But the fact that the plot is out of position has ultimately my mistake. I agree with everything that the planning office has put in his report, that the distances between the properties, the fact that we're not overlooking anybody. It's clear when you stand in front of the building, it's, I think it's close to 50 metres the separation you have. I've got an email I received today from one of the neighbours wishing us luck in the committee meeting today. Got their full support, that's number 23. And when the petition says that it's out of keeping with the area, number 16, Gayton Parkway, is a three-storey new build, which we built ourselves, finished in April this year. And the house next to that is a three-storey building, so it's not exactly out of character with the building. And there's not much more other than what Steve Lacey, the planning officer who's approved it, has put in his report.
Thank you very much.
You.
Could you just turn off your microphone, please? Thank you. Is Mr. Ward Council like to speak on this? No? Can I open this up to committee now, please?
Just very quickly, I mean, I think we need to make it clear to the objectors that separation distances, maybe not what they would like, but they are the legal requirement that we are required to comply with. And because it doesn't have to suit the objectors, it's not really a valid reason for us to turn things down. That's the first thing, of course. And the second thing is just to confirm that this particular building in its new location, as you started off by saying, Matthew, is virtually identical to the one that we previously approved, and presumably all the issues that were discussed at that time with the residents have now been raised again, and they've already been considered one. So we do have in fact an extant permission which exists, and if the building had been built to that condition, there would be no regress possible at this time. Just to clarify the issue, particularly with regard to separation distances, views obviously we can't take into account. It's just a matter of clarifying for the benefit of the objectors what the current true legal position is.
Sorry,
and also with regard to the fact that the building was started before it had planning permission. In that case, the applicant proceeded at his own risk. We have no control over starting an application before the application has been approved. So just clarify those points that we probably will. Thank you, Chair.
This is now the debate within the committee. I could ask you not to shout out, please. Thank you.
Thank you, through you, Chair. The minimum separation distances that we would look to achieve, windows and windows, 21 metres. And this is double that at 45 metres. In terms of, yes, it is true that the development has been commenced, the building is virtually unfinished, and planning permission wasn't in place for that because it's not in accordance with the scheme that was approved earlier this year. But the council has to give the opportunity to any applicant to rectify any breach of planning control by the submission of a retrospective application, and this is what that applicant has done. So we're considering this application on its own merits, but having regard to what has been approved twice, once in 2013 and again in 2015. The new dwelling as proposed in this application is 70 centimetres higher than that that was approved, or the ridge was approved in April. But both this side and the other side are actually lower than what was it, that was what approved in April of this year. Substantially, the building remains as approved in April. It just has been reorientated slightly differently on the site.
Thank you.
Steve?
Just some confirmation. Was mentioned in the objector's speech about a oak tree being removed. Are any of the trees that have been removed protected, and would there be any enforcement action?
The trees are not subject to a preservation order in the Elderton conservation area. There is a condition on the agenda papers that requires the submission of additional landscaping.
Denise?
Thank you, Chair. Can I have approval of this as a recommendation, please, Chair?
Okay, do we have a second? Irene, Okay, the officer's recommendation is to approve subject to the conditions listed. All those in favour? Against? Any abstentions? That's carried, thank you. Agenda item 4 is subject to a site visit, so if we can go to agenda item 5, please, which is pages 37 to 48, Cammell Town Road. Matthew, can you have a presentation, please?
Thank you, through your chair. This application seeks permission for a crew transfer capability along with office and storage space in connection with the offshore wind turbine industry. This application follows a temporary 3-year consent granted in 2012 for warehousing and storage facilities in connection with the construction of the Winterbore offshore wind farm. The large construction laid down area required with that consent is no longer required and therefore does not form part of these proposals. This application seeks permanent permission for office facilities, storage facilities and car parking area together with a gangway and pontoon to facilitate the transfer of crew to and from river vessels. The office and storage facilities are already in place following the 3-year permission granted in 2012 and will be permanently retained in their positions as part of these proposals. The area is predominantly industrial in character and the proposals are in keeping with the site's designation as primary industrial. All environmental impacts have been carefully considered and the development will not have any adverse impacts on the environment. The activities being undertaken on site require a coastal location supporting the offshore wind turbine industry. The site is industrial in character and the proposals fit comfortably with the industrial designation of the area and surrounding uses. The application is recommended for approval. There is no petition of rejection in connection with this application.
Thank you, Matthew. Is there a ward council would like to speak on this? No, can I open this to the committee, please? No, Jeff?
I'm with approval.
Thank you, Jeff. Do we have a second then? Thank you, Denise. The officer's recommendation is to approve subject to the conditions listed. All those in favour? That's unanimous. That's carried. Thank you. We'll now move to agenda item 6, which is pages 49 to 56, 79 Rose Mount, Oxford. Matthew, can have a presentation, please.
Thank you, through you, Chair. This application seeks permission for the variation of a condition to allow for additional opening hours. The application seeks permission to bring the planning hours in line with the approved licensing hours. The premises would open at 9 a.m. every day and would be open until 12:30 Monday to Thursday, 1:30 on Fridays and Saturdays, and until midnight on Sundays. However, the public will not be granted entry past 11:30 Monday to Saturday and past 11 p.m. on Sunday. The additional hours are to allow customers already on the premises to drink up and then leave the premises. The hours are the same as those applied for in 2014 and refused by the Planning Committee in January this year. However, unlike that application, this current application is supported by a noise assessment and acoustic report that has looked at the impacts likely to be generated by allowing an extension to hours. That report concludes that the proposed extended hours will not significantly alter the overall noise climate in the vicinity, and in fact the qualitative assessment suggests that noise in the vicinity is dominated by that from Hodson Bar and Grill and the outdoor seating and smoking area at that establishment. That property is unrestricted in planning terms due to the historic use of the site as a drinking establishment. Having regard to the information contained and the conclusions put forward in the noise assessment and acoustic report, which has been assessed by colleagues in environmental protection, it is considered that a refusal of planning permission is unlikely to be robustly defended in appeal. The proposed extension of hours is considered to be acceptable and the application is recommended for approval. There is a qualifying petition of objection.
Would the lead petitioner like to come forward? Can I just ask, are you speaking on behalf of the petitioner, councillor, or are you speaking as councillor?
Can I have a choice?
Yes.
Right, well, I will speak as simply as a ward councillor.
Thank you.
Not
up to that yet. can I just ask that if there is a petitioner that would like to speak on behalf of the petition? Okay, so if there isn't a petitioner, the agent isn't allowed to speak, so if we go straight directly to the ward councillor, please. Thank you.
Could
you just state your name for
a bit? Thank you, Chair. Alan Brickhouse. Yes, you've heard, I'll try and be as quick as I can, so there's only a few points I want to make. This application did come before the Planning Committee, as you've heard, and many of you were moved over there earlier in the year, and it was refused. And I think the circumstances that led to you coming to the conclusion to refuse is I don't believe they've changed. I think they remain exactly as they were. And in that regard, I think there are probably three factors that indeed were considered then and indeed should be considered again today. Firstly, there's the question of planning law and licensing opening times. There's no requirement in planning law that the opening times should be the same as those agreed by licensing. And it's not surprising that they're not, because the criteria for licensing and the criteria for planning are different. And as is pointed out in the report, that within a primarily residential area, then you as the planning committee do need to take into account not only any noise or disturbance from the courtyard, but from any other activities that take place in the surrounding area. Yours is a much wider brief, whereas licensing tends to be looking very much at the premises and the management of the premises itself. The second point I'd just like to make is, again, as we've heard, the applicant justifies this application primarily on the basis that it would bring the opening hours to the courtyard in line with that of the Oxton Bar and Kitchen. Well, Oxton, as it happens, has the highest density of licensed premises anywhere in Wirral. And the Oxton Bar and Kitchen is only one of them. So the licensing hours for, the opening hours for the restaurant immediately to up Rose Mount to the side of the courtyard, the one further up, the one across the road, or even the Shrewsbury Arms around the corner. None of those are anywhere near the same as the Oxton Bar and Kitchen. The Oxton Bar and Kitchen is very much the exception to the rule. It is not the norm in Oxton, and only that establishment has this late opening. The third point, that I think this was discussed at the last time this came before the committee, is this question of distances to residential properties in the close vicinity of the courtyard. The report points out that there is a block of flats or some flats that are sort of diagonally 45 metres from the front door of the courtyard across the road. But also bear in mind, again as is said in the report, there is a flat immediately above the courtyard, above all the properties, all the properties going up Rose Mount have flats directly above them, and directly opposite the entrance of the courtyard there is a flat. It just so happens that the front door is round the corner in Village Road, so it doesn't quite fit in with the criteria. But nevertheless, there are residential properties in very close proximity. And again, as is mentioned in the report, also in Price's Lane, immediately behind the courtyard. The one difference that again you've heard tonight is that the applicant commissioned a noise report in conjunction with the levels of noise and potential disturbance in the area. And the report indicates that it would be a minimal impact. The point of, just really two points I would say to that. One is that if the the hours are extended to half past one, you will then have the courtyard and the Oxton Barn and kitchen as the only two premises that would be would have customers leaving at half past one in the morning. The courtyard, as many of you I'm sure have visited the lights of Oxton Village, the courtyard is a very popular venue. I don't think I'm being emotive, but I say if you go past there on a Friday, Saturday night, it's pretty full, and particularly around the bar area, it would be there'd be a considerable number of people in there. And therefore, I think when this is a 100% increase. It's a doubling of the number of late night customers that are actually coming out of leaving premises as late as half past one in the morning. I find it hard to say that is only going to have a minimal impact in the way that the noise report does. It also made reference to the garden area of the Oxton Bar and Kitchen and claims that a lot of noise comes from there. Indeed, quite a lot of noise does come from there, but nobody uses that area after 11 o'clock at night. Well, they do. The only people who use it are smokers, and in the same way as the courtyard smokers are out in the road in Rosemount. So it does create noise, but it doesn't create noise at the times that we're concerned about, which is in the early hours of Saturday and Sunday morning. I think that basically is all the points I wanted to make. I think the residents feel that they would look to the planning laws to provide them with some protection and maintain the immunity value in the area. So I would ask this committee to be consistent with its previous decision, to uphold that decision, and reject this application. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. I understand there's another ward council who would like to speak on this. Thank you. You can just state your name for the...
Yes,
please.
Thank you, Chair.
And turn your microphone on, please.
Yeah, thank you, Chair, and councillors and officers for this opportunity to speak. I'm Paul Doughty, Labour councillor for Oxton Ward. Tonight I'm here to talk in response to the requests that I've had to represent the views of the businesses in Oxton Village, many of whom are also residents in close proximity to the village centre. And as a ward councillor, I do feel I have a responsibility to represent in a firm manner all of the views that have been shared with me. As you know, Oxton Village is a thriving, bustling community. We're a busy community. And much of the fact that the village is busy is because of the presence of the bars and restaurants that are there. However, I myself have owned restaurants in the past and how difficult it is to make ends meet. Currently in the village we actually have at least three empty shops. So although the village is doing okay, it struggled at times, and you know, as business owners there are pressures on them to make things work. And I feel we have a responsibility to support the businesses. The Oxton Courtyard has had considerable investment in the premises. It's actually the largest employer in the village centre, and I believe conducted business in a responsible manner. We're not here tonight to talk about the existence of whether the courtyard should be there or not. It's to talk about the licensing hours where the courtyard have made representation to me, asking that they just be treated the same as other establishments already in the village, and that's what they're asking for. And the point that I've made to them is, well, you know, surely if we extend your hours, the village will get busier. But what they're saying to me is that actually what happens is, because their licensing hours are shorter, people just drink up and go along. to the other establishments, the Oxford Bar Kitchen, which is open longer. And yes, it was refused on the last occasion, but it was refused because we were asking for a report, a sound report, which has been produced. And one of the summaries that was given is that the report concluded the Euro is quite noisy, but this is in keeping with the character of the area, and there is no significant difference between the current closing time and the proposed closing times, i.e. the village does not become quieter once the courtyard is closed, and when the courtyard is closing, it made almost no impact on the overall noise. Now, I know as Ward Councillor knocking on the doors and talking to the people who live in the village centre, and by the way, I live very close to the village centre myself, but I'm here tonight as a non-drinker, so I'm actually here to support the businesses in the village, even though I don't frequent them. Well, not the bars anyway. I do go to the shops for a bar of chocolate now and then. But the things that have been raised to me is actually the noise of the taxis. That's the issue we have. We have problems with parking, we have problems with taxis. And to refuse this application against the officer's advice is not actually going to resolve, in my mind, what the real issues are in the village, and that is to do with the noise of the taxis and the ongoing issues with parking. And they're the issues that we need to address, and if we can support the local businesses, perhaps we can find solutions to those individual problems. As I say, the Oxygen Courtyard is fully aware of its responsibilities. They have doormen on the door. And just to give you an example of one of the complaints I had, someone phoned me up and I went to visit them. They were irate because they'd had bottles of Budweiser thrown into their garden and they came from the courtyard. Well, the courtyard doesn't sell Budweiser bottles, and the doormen wouldn't let them leave the premises with bottles in their hands anyway. So I do think there's an amount of excitement about this application that isn't justified, and I believe we have a responsibility to support the businesses in a fair and equitable way, particularly since these particular applicants are residents of the village as well, as are many of the businesses that we have there. So that they were my points. I'm here to represent the residents and the businesses, and hopefully I've done so in a fair manner. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Can I open this up to committee, please?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I totally agree with what Paul's just said. I don't think it's fair on the business for us to withhold hours of business when they should be selling alcohol and they can't because of us as a planning committee, although their licence says they can. We have the final, you know, restriction on it. I approve, I mean, I will be voting for approval on this application. I don't know whether anybody else wants to chat about it.
Okay, can I take
Matt,
please?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I mean, I, like Paul and many others, represent an area that has sometimes conflict between business and residents, and it is always hard to strike that balance about who you represent, and I think Paul did that very well there. I actually voted for this last time, from memory, and I feel that with the noise impact assessment, taking into account what I thought was my view at the time, backing that up almost, that I think I'd be minded to vote for this again.
Thank you, Chair. I was on the planning committee last time this came up, and I voted for it. I don't see any problem with it insofar as nobody else is allowed in the premise after 11:30. It's just a question of existing customers drinking for an hour longer and then leaving. It doesn't necessarily mean that they will leave at 1:30, but they can just leave any time between 11:30 and 1:30, so I don't have a problem with it. Thank you, Cathy. Jo?
I'll just be brief. I've also